story of a man who dies in the hospital. And his wife comes sitting there and does 3 days, 3 nights. And somewhere on the third day, it was even midnight, day, she lay on the side of the door to sleep. And he felt it when she rolled off to sleep. And at the same time, he felt himself starting to die. And he wanted to see him die. So he took his book back and he saw the way. And he wrote it.
Jesus answers all my prayers. Blessed be the Father, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. Thanks be to God. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Let's hear from Elvis.
Phil, and your story. he was 11 years older than me. So I said, that's right. I was a Brooklyn girl, and he lived in Jersey. Well, a funny story was we were going to a concert, and Phil always had to take photos. And it said, absolutely no cameras allowed. And Phil was panicking. He's in the parking lot in an absolute panic, wearing height, wearing height. And this is a church, so I'm trying to try to keep this. So God forgive me. So he goes, well, he goes, let's stick it in my penile area. This way, if anybody, you know, sees it, maybe they'll think that I have direction. So I actually helped Phil shove this little camera, you know, video camera into his pants, and he was literally walking with his bulge. And he goes, do you think about that? I get caught, I'll get thrown out. I said, well, we're going to get thrown out together. But he managed it, he managed, and he got his videos. And I just want to say that Phil and I shared a love for each other through Elvis. And I know that might be hard for some people to understand, but there was such a deep love for Elvis that that was our connection for over 50 years. And, you know, you're grateful for God's little gifts. You know, you don't see the gifts that God brings us because we ignore them most of the time. And I want to thank God first because God controls everything, and I understand that. But God gave that little gift that I didn't notice was a 50-year gift that not only brought a friendship for a lifetime, but that gift was a second gift to my son as a surrogate father and as his best friend. So through God's love and kindness and through our love for Elvis, Phil and I will be eternally together because as long as Elvis sings and there's a movie, and my grandbaby says, oh, Elvis is on the tree and Phil is always alive. And I just wanted to share that. Thank you.
I think the funny stories are the best stories. That's my personal opinion. Who else has a story they'd like to share? Okay.
My name is Tom Salva. I've known Phil for over 45 years. I think we met in Vintage Vinyl for his record store. And you know it had to be music. And you know, the video up there, and sometimes the best memories hurt the worst, you know, but I said that Phil and I went to spend as much time together in Memphis after we happened in New Jersey here. And the two loaves of down the road for dinner and at the Graceland North, I can't space my name right now. But, you know, I just like to say about Phil is that, you know, the score part of life, he was a good son, he was a good brother, he was a good husband, he was a good friend. He's a good man. So he won the game, you know, and I'm going to miss him. And, you know, rest in peace, though. Thanks for nothing but good memories.
Yeah. believe it was my stepdad, said, "So, Phil, what do you do for a living?" And he said, with a very straight, serious voice, "I have dedicated my life to the preservation of the memory of Elvis and President." Well, we were like, "Oh, okay." So, of course, my grandfather, who had worked in a factory all his life, turned and said something like, "Oh, really? How much is that paying out?" We're like, "Oh, boy." But since that time, we just learned to just embrace Phil, love him. He taught us a lot. I want to say thank you, especially to Cousin Phil and Cousin Debbie. Really, they shared that love of photography. And my mother actually was a photographer herself. And he really taught us that importance of, before you leave the room, before you leave an event, a family reunion, something special, don't forget to take that one last picture. Have some of our favorite, this is my brother here, some of our favorite family photos. I am ashamed to say, we're like, "Oh boy, he's leaving, get ready, we're gonna have to take a family photo." And down in our lobby of our house, our foyer, he would always have us sit on this kind of brick bench that was in there. And every Christmas before he left, we all had to get on that brick bench and take that photo. And those are some of the most wonderful memories I have and treasures I have of Phil's photos of our family. And so I really have to thank Phil, first of all, for teaching us how to love life and embrace what makes you happy. Of course, for him, it was Elvis. And also, I have to thank him for the lesson. I'll never forget to take that one last photo. Thank you, Cousin Phil.
I'll try to make this brief, but I think I've known Phil longer than anyone in this room for 700 years. Started the, one of my first memories is sharing a crib with Phil. And then sharing a room with Phil. And I remember growing up, Phil was always two grades ahead of me. He would read me Winnie the Pooh before I had learned to read, and he was just learning to read. And every night he would read a different chapter. When he was learning the geography or history, we had a big map of the world on the wall. He would show me how Magellan navigated the Straits of Magellan and everything. And, I don't want to bore everyone, but I had 73 years of adventures with Phil in our childhood. Phil, I guess the first thing, before there was Elvis, there was Wider. He had the belt, he had the Betsy, and I was always George, David Crockett's hat. And Phil was always David Crockett. And once in a while my mother had to take that David Crockett belt and whack him once in a while and water. And then it was Wider, a little Western. Before Elvis, there's pictures of all, and especially Weyerberg. Phil did get to meet you, O'Brien. He did get to meet Bess Carr earlier, who brought us all pictures of him. And I guess as far as stories, I'll give you one. I probably have many, but we were, when I was in the fourth grade, in Miss Kent's class, we were both in Roseville Avenue School. I don't know if you remember Miss Kent, but she was very strict. You do, yes, disciplinarian. And one day I got called to the principal's office, and I don't know, what is this green-black on our principal? So I went down there, Phil's there in the office with his feet on the desk, and he says, "I'm the principal now." She put me in charge while she's out. Actually, she had me there to answer the phone because she had to go out for a while. So, and somehow, I guess, she liked Phil. So we're in the office, and with our feet on the desk, reading all the books, running around. I was in the fourth grade, he was in the sixth. And then he said, "You better go back up to your class." And so I went back, and fine. A couple days later, I get called down to the office again. Miss Kent, I stayed a little too long. After about an hour, she came down there. Phil never got to be principal again. boys, but we all love the brother.
I don't know about the rest of you, but I have a little picture filled with the state of the principal's desk. I understand. And there's something.
This is the story of a Christmas that Stu Cousins has. When I was working in New York City, Chuck Berry did a book signing at a store near my work. So I said, Phil's never going to make it to this city on the weekend in the morning. So I went to the bookstore, got a book autographed with his name from Chuck Berry, and a Christmas comes. So I wrap up the book, and we go down in James, and we give him the book. And he's like, all surprised and everything, you know?
Thank you.
hard to sum up the life of a person that was so full of life. The stories that were shared today were only a glimpse into the memories that were made with Phil over the years. For those that really knew him, you know that Phil is listening in right now and wondering who's documenting this momentous occasion. It's all part of the story, his story, so unless you want the ghost of Phil to come back and haunt you, somebody better take some pictures. Everybody that spoke about Phil today shared a different perspective, a different angle, based on how they knew the guy. Some knew him as brother, husband, or friend, but I knew him as my daddy-o. Phil never had a kid of his own. He never had a son, but in 2005, in a strange sort of way, I was born. Let me explain. It all starts with Elvis. With Phil, clearly. What didn't start with Elvis? My mom, as you heard, met Phil over 50 years ago. As diehard, lifelong Elvis fans, their love for the king created a friendship for the ages. I was casually introduced to him a few times over the years, but in 2005, my mom decided to host an Elvis party and invited her friends Phil and Dave. For those that knew both of them, they were a package deal, for sure. I didn't know it yet, but that party would be the day I'd meet my two best friends. We met, took some photos, lots of photos, sang some songs, shared some stories, and the party was over. One afternoon, soon after, a skinny old man walked into the pharmacy where I worked and said, "Hey, buddy, thought I'd stop by and say hello." It was none other than Mr. Gelormine. At first, I'm thinking, why is this old guy coming to visit a 17-year-old kid? But then we talked and talked and talked. He ended up visiting me every weekend for over a month or two. And eventually I said, "Do you want to just go grab lunch? A rum and coke and a glass of white Zinfandel at Applebee's," and we were officially a party of two. Every Saturday night for the next few months, Dave and I would buy a bottle of wine and hit up a BYOB for dinner. Yes, I was 17, but nobody asks your age when you're drinking with a 75-year-old man. A few months into our friendship, and Phil says to Dave, "Why do you keep bothering that kid? You guys go to dinner every week, doesn't he have people his own age that he wants to hang out with?" I didn't. Dave was much more fun than anybody my age. Dave responded, "No, he calls me. And we always have a great time. We should do dinner, the three of us, one time." "We'll see," said Phil. On the night of the Academy Awards, it was tradition for Phil, Dave, and Debbie to go to the Thai kitchen for dinner. So Dave called me and said, "You should come to dinner with us, it'll be fun." I said, "Did you ask Phil?" Dave responds quickly, yeah, he's fine with it." So I agreed, I walked into the restaurant, saw Phil, and his face said it all. "Why is this kid here?" Dave never asked Phil if it was okay. We talked, we laughed, we drank, we told stories, and suddenly Phil said, "If you want, you can come back to our place and join us for the Oscars." I was having fun, so on we went. That night, Phil grabbed, if I remember correctly, some amaretto, and Dave grabbed the smokes, Eastwoods, as they call them, and we did our first bench. A 17-year-old, a 59-year-old, and a 75-year-old, the most random mixed bag for a friendship. But we were officially a party of three, and the three musketeers were born. A few years and countless stories later, they asked me if I would mind driving them to a concert. Dave was too old to drive comfortably at night anymore, and Phil's eyesight wasn't ever really good enough for him to drive at all. So they asked me if I'd take them to a show at Nassau Coliseum, their treat. What show? Bruce Springsteen and the E Street Band. I didn't really know much at all about Bruce at the time, but of course I said yes. And when that show kicked off on March 10, 2008, 2 seconds in, I was hooked, and a lifelong Bruce fan was born. Interesting point, when Phil saw Bruce the first time, he opened the show with the song Night. When I saw him for the first time, he opened the show with the song Night. And the day I started writing this for Phil, later that night, Bruce opened with a tour premiere of, you guessed it, Night. Strange coincidence, who knows, but I certainly felt some sort of divine intervention at play. Over the next decade, we had some fun. Boy, did we have fun. We went out every Thursday night for martini night. We saw Tony Bennett, Willie Nelson, Bob Dylan, John Mellencamp, the Oak Ridge Boys, Michael Bublé, you name it, and of course Bruce. Lots and lots of Bruce. We went every few months, could have been every few weeks at one point, to Atlantic City, and I taught Phil how to gamble. He actually came home and opened a bank account at TD Bank for his gambling money. I went to family parties. They came over for Christmas Eve. We slept at Phil's brother Bob's house, probably after a day of heavy drinking. I even joined the Coconuts on stage live and played trombone with Phil's alter ego, Jersey Guy. I mentioned earlier that Phil never had a son, but over that 10-year period of time, I became his sonny boy. He used to always joke that I had too many fathers. I had my actual father, my stepfather, my godfather, but I only had one daddy. And it was one of the true honors of my life to be his son. Phil never took life too seriously. When my great aunt passed away at the age of 100, he wrote to me on Facebook, "This is the cycle of life, isn't it? God giveth and God taketh away. What a long, wonderful life she had. This, my sonny boy, is why we take pictures. I will be clicking in my coffin one last shot, but I guess I may need a little help before they close the lid. Just make sure it's my good side." How very Phil of him. As a photographer, he never missed a moment. Never. I actually feel bad for Debbie because she's going to have to dig through hundreds of thousands of establishing shots taken at the front of the post office, Best Buy, Houlihan's, you name it, and hundreds of thousands of more safety shots taken just to be sure the first photo wasn't missed. Life, in a way, is like a camera. Focus on what's important. Capture the good times, develop from the negatives, and if things don't work out, take another shot. Phil always took another shot. Near the end, I had the privilege to be able to sit with Phil and reminisce, listen to Bruce, and feed him his meals, and maybe a Wendy's vanilla frosty or two. I'll never forget one of my last visits when he was still able to communicate. I told him all about the Springsteen tour opener in Tampa, and I read him the set list. And he asked, "Can you play No Surrender? That's a great show opener." Sure, pal. So, how do we put a bow on this and wrap it up? How do we close the final curtain, turn the last page, and close the book on a life as big as Phil's? I don't think we do. I think we keep writing our own story and remember that Phil will always be a part of our life and carry on inside each of us until our own time comes. For now, though, I'll wrap it up the best way I know how. Well, they built the Titanic to be one of a kind, the many ships that ruled the sea. They built the Eiffel Tower to stand alone, but they could build another if they please. The Taj Mahal, the pyramids of Egypt, are unique, I suppose. But when they built you, brother, they broke the mold. Now the world is filled with many wonders under the passing sun. Sometimes something comes along and you know it's for sure the only one. The Mona Lisa, the David, the Sistine Chapel, Jesus, Mary, and Joe. When they built you, brother, they broke the mold. When they built you, brother, they turned dust into gold. When they built you, brother, they broke the mold. They say you can't take it with you, but I think that they're wrong. Because all I know is I woke up this morning and something big was coming.
Go into that dark ether where you're still young and hard and cold. Just like when they built you, brother, they broke the mold. Now your death is upon us, and we'll return your ashes to the earth. And I know you'll take comfort in knowing you've been roundly blessed. But love is a power greater than death, just like the songs and stories told. And when they built you, brother, they broke the mold. That attitude's a power stronger than death, alive and burning her stone cold. When they built you, brother, they broke the mold. So, here at the end of all things, I guess I'm the last musketeer standing. But keep the drinks cold, pal. I'm not in a hurry, but one day I know we'll toast again to the good old days. Say hi to the guy for me. See you on the other side, Daddy-o. All for one. One for all.
Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to Jesus, Lord, if we do not know where you are going, how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. In a few moments, we're going to hear that Elvis knew a little bit about In My Father's House. Just as Elvis had a lot to say about God, for those who maybe didn't know. And in a few of the conversations that I had been having with Phil over the years, often on a Christmas Eve, before Debbie had quite made it downstairs, we would share just a quick reminiscence of how beautiful the sanctuary was, filled with candlelight. And you'd always see Phil often over in that side corner, dressed in his best for Christmas Eve, just taking it all in. I imagine there are a few photos he may have stuck in on Christmas Eve along the way. We love to see those if you dig them up among all of the other photos. Phil was a gift to those who had the opportunity to know him, even if it was sometimes for some weekly events or more, and for others of us, maybe at family functions, and for others on those occasions when we got to see him here in this place. Debbie chose the reading from Romans today because of a line, and this was the name of Phil's youth group, essentially, in high school, right? In the church that he grew up in. More than conquerors, right? And as I was reflecting on this reading from Romans, this one comes up every once in a while when we do a funeral or a memorial service. A lot of people choose that. Ecclesiastes, there's a time for every season. Beautiful, beautiful scripture. But this one sounds like Phil. Well, nothing's going to stop me from doing what I need to do to get the photo. And nothing's going to stop me from celebrating eternal life with God. Nothing. I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from God's love. Nothing. The gift that we get to hear today from our God is that nothing separates us. We receive the gift of eternal life because nothing separates us. And in that same way that God loves us, we are called to love one another. And when we love each other that way, where nothing separates us, we get to keep the drinks cold. We get to hold on to that hope that there will be a day where we are together again. Because nothing separates us. Nothing. Rest in that today. Rest in the love that Phil showed to you and the love that you got to share with one another. Nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing. We rest in that hope separates us from one another. Amen. We are going to hear again from the dying. And this is a reflection on that gospel text here.
In my Father's house of prayer, thank you.
And one other announcement, as you leave this space, please take
So, I first of all want to say a huge thank you to all of you who have given me so much love and support, all of my families, my blood family, my church family, my heart family. You've been such gracious support for Phil and for me as he walked this last part of his life. And the last piece of music we have for you, Jeff sort of spilled the beans a while ago, and I don't know if anybody caught it, but there is a YouTube channel which features videos by a fellow who goes by the name of Jersey Guy. Now, in true Superman Clark Kent fashion, there was always a rumor that Phil was Jersey Guy. Never substantiated, never disproven. But Jersey Guy wanted to leave us with this today.
Thank you. I'm right.